Floyd always said, I hate to Floyd always said, I hate to cut off the fellowship.
Mm-hmm. 5:28. Praise God from whom all blessed saints flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
947. Jesus, let us come to know you. Let us see you face to face. Touch us, hold us, use us, mold us. Only let us live in you. Jesus, draw us. This last Christmas, got to spend time with family, which I cherish and treasure. And I am there sitting at a place that we like to eat frequently when we go home. It's got flavor of home. It's something I grew up with. So we're sitting there eating, and about that time my nephew tells me that I'm his favorite uncle, and I said, well, that's the other one. We have a little friendly argument. Then we get in his pickup, and I'm looking around just admiring, as I've done before. We got a new little toy. And the new little toy that he got was he got a CB radio. When he got the CB radio, he told me, I'm pretty sure you need to get a CB. Well, I have very fond memories of CB radio. My aunt always had one, and when I get to go with her over to Pawnee, Texas, which there's a major artery that goes from southeast Texas all the way up into Colorado and Montana and the border, Canadian border. And we'd be listening to truck drivers, and we'd be listening to them talk about this and talk about that. And then, especially why they had the CBs was because they wanted to see where the Smokies were. One of my favorite stories my aunt told, I didn't get to be with her when she came up. She said that there was a man that was asking for a Smokey report from that Carrollton town. Well, at the town that she lived in Carrollton, Texas, and she was headed home, about four. 3.5 hour trip. And she said, it's clear. About 5 minutes later, the guy came back on and said, I thought you said it was clear. He said, now all I've seen is Okies are from Smokies from one end to the other. She said, well, it was back in that Carrollton, Texas town. He said, did you say Carrollton, Texas? That radio had skipped all the way to Carrollton, South Carolina. And then the other story that she always loved to tell was about the Smokies, and you have to know a little bit of history of television, and that is, one of the truck drivers asked her, is that a hemorrhoid with a Polaroid, or is that a Kodak with a Kodak? And I was laughing because I could grabbed that CD the other day. It took us a while to get it, and I wasn't in any hurry for it. And I still laugh about it. I hear this one guy in particular, especially when I'm in the Marines Valley, and he's just talking about the work, that work ethic of young people today. That's his soapbox, and he keeps on and keeps on. And then he ends it with back to the bench. Boy, what's that? And 30 seconds later, he comes back on, he starts ranting and raving again. My son and I were driving the other day, he said, what is he talking about? I said, he's talking about your generation that doesn't want work. And he goes, oh, I know that. He was the recipient of some of his friends. He works at school as a custodian. His friends got real mad at him because he got paid about twice as much as they did. And they didn't think that was very fair. Reminded me of Matthew 21, the two sons. Finally, somebody said to the supervisor, why did you pay Christopher more than you did me? And they said, because he shows up to school and goes to work. You stay home and do nothing. Well, a lot of things that I like about playing with that radio, and I'll tell you one of the things that I've got to do here in the next few days, and if I don't get it done, so what? Because my father-in-law gave me a pickup with a radio in it, and so Christopher and I, we've been kind of playing, which is fun. The first thing you got to do is, if you want to operate that CB, you got to turn that radio on. If you want to have the power of God, the blessings of God, you thought this all had to do with the CB, didn't you? If you want to have the blessings of God, you want to have the power of God, and you want to have the blessed hope of God, you got to plug into God. That radio doesn't work. Of course, I like to turn the squelch down. I drive some people crazy, and that's fine. I love to turn the squelch down because a lot of times you can't hear what's skipping across. And it's fascinating to me how radios can do that thing. How can a radio skip across the country? How can it go 4 miles, 5 miles, the direct line of sight? Or how can it just go a mile and a half? And then we've been hearing when somebody gets a major, or Freeport is hauling some major thing, or there's some major boat home coming through. You hear the guy telling the guy in the truck, for example, the other day he's coming through Bayer, and he says, I've got a, what do you call that, an M&M on the side? I thought that was cool. I never heard a car called an M&M. You do know, though, why the blonde quit working at the M&M factory, because she couldn't get the W's out. Okay, I thought I'd share that with you. And if you need me to help you with that later, I'll tell you. But when he turned that on, and when we turned that on as Christian people, we were just like the story of the prodigal son. Now, really, let me make a disclaimer here. I only call it the story of the prodigal son because that's which we're familiar with. That's not the real story here. The real story is the story of the wonderful Father. Every day, God is looking for his children. Every day that father was looking for his son. And when that son came to his senses, what did he do? He said, I know that my father has hired servants and has bread enough to spare. I don't know what I'll do. I'll go home, tell my father, I've sinned against heaven and in your sight, and I'm no longer worthy to be called your son, make me one of your servants. But when that father chased him from afar, hugged him, kissed his neck, and when he looked in the eyes of his father, and I can't prove that last part, but you know very good and well, he knew his father. And he said, Father, I've sinned against heaven and in your sight, and I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. He could not say the last few words. Or he wasn't allowed to say the last few words. I don't know which. But I do know this. The father said, bring the best robe. Bring the sandals. Bring the ring. For this my son was dead and is alive now. something about my two brothers, that son of yours. You know what? No. This eldest boy was the first one to say, this son of yours. He wouldn't even recognize him as a brother anymore. He went out and lived in riotous living. You know that. The boy admitted he did. And that's why the dad said, everything I have belongs to you. But he could not reconcile with his brother. Well, how about the Apostle Paul? We know him as Saul at the time in Acts chapter 9. Here he is. And he is on his way to bring back Christians, Jews, that's the only Christians we had at the time, bring them back to Jerusalem and have them stoned to death. But what happened? In Acts chapter 9, when he hears that Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? And I know some people try to downplay what Saul did, what Saul said. But you don't go and say, Lord, unless you recognize there's somebody there. You don't say, who are you, Lord, unless there's some idea that there's a Lord. And you imagine, I wish we had been able to have a video. You know, there are times that when, I'm going to pick on the sack. There are times when my kids will be speechless. There are times that I'll be speechless. And I'll say, I wish I had a picture of this. I wish I had some picture of them when they were just. Can you imagine what Saul must have done when he heard the words, when he said, who are you, Lord? I am Jesus of Nazareth, whom you're persecuting. Don't you know it is hard for you to kick against goats? I can only imagine. I'm not trying to add anything to the Word of God. Please don't throw something at me. But human nature would be, this is the guy that would go and say, along with the rest of the Jews made, the disciples of Jesus stole his body. They paid the guards to say that the disciples stole his body. So, when he heard those words, he did exactly what Jesus told him to do. And Jesus didn't tell him how to be saved. I want to emphasize something here. Jesus does not tell people how to be saved. That almost sounds like I'm being sacrilegious. It sounds like I'm being blasphemous. But when he told Saul, go to the street called Straight, Acts 22, and it will be told what you need to do in order to be saved. And when he did, Ananias thought God was lying, or not lying, I'm sorry, thought God, you know, this is all set up. He said, go, for he's a chosen vessel of mine. He's a chosen vessel of mine. I'm going to show him how these things he must suffer for my name's sake. These people, when he got up in the synagogue, he went and preached the very person he was trying to destroy. In fact, he called it in Acts 23, the way. He plugged in. That's why he can say what he can say in 1 Corinthians 15:10, by the grace of God, I am what I am. How about Apollos? Acts 18, verse 20, we'll talk about Apollos in a minute. Acts 16, how about Philippians chapter? He just knew that all those prisoners escaped. An earthquake happened. Paul and Silas are singing the old hee-haw song. Singing that Paul and Silas did influenced every one of those prisoners course God helped. And Paul said, do yourself no harm, for we're all here. And the first thing that jailer did, he took and he washed their stripes, brought his house, and they all obeyed the gospel. They all loved him. Now, when I plug that radio in, I can hear all kinds of things, and I like it. I like it. It's almost as good to me as listening to AM radio at night. We used to, a friend of mine and I used to do that. He lived about a quarter mile, and he'd walk over, or we'd walk over. And he was Hispanic and could speak English real well. Or could speak English and Spanish real well, sorry. And so we were listening to some radio station. I have no idea where it was. It could have been El Paso for all I know. And we were listening there for a minute, and all of a sudden I said, Licio, what is he saying? He said, I have no idea what he's saying. I almost fell off the pickup just out of laughter. Because he, you know, he could speak Spanish and English, but couldn't figure out what that guy was trying to say. And here, the jailer obeyed the gospel. Obeyed the gospel. You have to turn that thing on. And you can hear all kinds of things. Now, there's some things, granted, you don't want to hear. For example, I got on the radio on another ranch vehicle, and and these guys were cussing their hell. Well, my dad made the mistake of telling me, or trying to feed me what I should say to these guys. It was clean. And I asked them very politely to stop using that kind of language. And I got an earful. And finally, one of them said something about, what are you, an old man? And my dad said, tell them I'm old, or I'm slow, but I'm old, but you're slow. What's your excuse? And it went on and on and on. And finally, I just said, Dad, let's just turn it off. I could not get them to stop using both language. There's things you won't listen to. I could have put that in there, but I thought, well, you know what? Let's just make it real simple here. I don't know what happened to all my notes here. Oh, there it is. To operate it, you got to make adjustments. Now, I didn't know this. I thought what you did is you take your magnetic, that's the one I've got, and then I've got only the other pickup I got ready. I've got an antenna my nephew recommended. And you take that magnet, you can give you an Allen wrench, and you put that thing in there. Well, on the radio I got, there's what's called SWR, and there's calibrated and all that stuff. And it's not quite above my pay grade, but pretty close. And I'm like, what do you do with all that? Well, we're just in play. We're not in, you know, if somebody wants to talk to us, we'll talk to them. If somebody wants to discuss something, we'll discuss something. But you have to make certain adjustments. If you don't want to listen to all that noise, you turn the squelch on. And that squelch takes out that background noise. Now, me, I'm just crazy enough. I like that background noise. You can hear a lot more anyways, I told you. But you can tune that thing to dynamic. I don't know what that means. You can tune that thing to and try to. And then what you have to do is you have to take that Allen wrench, loosen that antenna wire just enough, and go up by a quarter of an inch and see if that. Sound wave radio signals, frequency or something like that. You know, sometimes we have to make adjustments too. The preacher that used to be at home, he was preaching in Blackwell, Oklahoma, Bill Ed Walker. And he said, when he got together with his wife now, he was not a Christian. He was not going to be a member of the Church of Christ because they didn't teach the truth. They didn't teach any part of the truth. And so he was defiant. He didn't go to church where he thought he should go, but he was still defiant. He didn't want any part of it. Finally, he went with his wife one Sunday, and his people weren't so bad. First Peter 3 method. You let your influence bring you. And he said he studied with many trusted, and he studied on his own, and he came to find out, you know what? That's not what I believed was not in the Bible. What I thought was in the Bible was not in the Bible. There's a man that you can go to YouTube, and he's trying to tell members of the LGBT community that homosexuality and lesbianism, the lifestyles in the world, are abominable and wrong. And he read the scripture from 1 Corinthians 6, verse 9, and the guy is screaming at him and saying, that's not in there. That's not in there. He takes the Bible and turns it around. The guy won't even look at it. He won't even recognize it. He's preaching another time about another subject. And a guy walks up and said, if you don't shut up, I'm going to have my pistol and kill you. This is in the United States. It is already forbidden. It is already a hate crime to preach that way in Canada. Guess what country's coming next? Whether the priesthood of believers is scriptural. If you guys can explain that to me after church tonight, please let me know. It's crazy. How about Simon? Here's Simon in Acts chapter 8, the sorcerer. He was a practicing magician for the longest time, and not just a magician like Penn and Teller. He was into astrology. You remember we had that problem in the 80s. Dionne Warwick made more money off people. A friend of mine said he called one of those 1-900 numbers. I was tempted to get one just to see if how many people would call the numbers so we could make money off it. He said he called one of these 1-900 numbers and they said, you know, they know a lot about me. I said, that's because you told everything you wanted them to hear. He told them things that they just repeated back to him. And he was going to get married again. He was going to have millions of dollars. He never did. And I told him, I said, you mean to tell me you called that 1-900 number? As I said, I was just tempted to do that back in the 90s because that way we can make some money here. But I didn't do it. And now people don't know what? You're kidding. There's a 1-900 number at one time? Yeah, I didn't know that. Now, this is what I was trying to say a while ago. I jumped the gun. Apollos here. Here's Apollos in Acts chapter 18. He's an eloquent man. And he is able to refute the Jews with scriptures. There's only one problem he's got. He doesn't know the truth fully. Yes, he knows the necessity of baptism. Yes, he knows that Jesus was died, buried, rose from the grave the third day. He knows he's ascended. There's only one problem he's got. The baptism he knows is only the baptism. Priscilla and Aquila take him aside and show him the more accurate way. And when you go and study about him, he has a deeper relationship with the Lord. It is demonstrated in his leadership there at Corinth. sometimes we want to be forgiven. Now, let me qualify that before we throw something out. We do want to be forgiven. It's just so hard for us to wrap our minds around a perfect God with imperfect people. It is so hard for us to wrap our minds around a perfect God with imperfect people. But what does he do? I mean, we're just like that baby over Hobbs a year ago on Thanksgiving when that mother threw that baby in the dumpster. And what are cities doing around New Mexico? Putting in what's called safe haven boxes. We've got one here in Bay Area. That's the same thing that God took pity on us and looked at us, and the late Stafford North says, God found a way to kill two birds with one stone. And that is, he found a way to offer his son to pay the penalty of his justice. To pay the demand of his justice. Hard to imagine. Now, I didn't put this in the notes. Apparently I've got a mess and I apologize. I don't know how, but there is one way with that CB that can get you in trouble. And that is going beyond what God wants you to know. Going beyond what you should know. There have been times when I have the CB at school, or my CB would have a two-way. And all of a sudden the kids hear something. Because I've got it. And I only have it just to find help. And all of a sudden they got mad at me because I went and got an earpiece and put it in my ear. What did you do that for? So you can't hear what's going on. Isn't it amazing how people want to know things that they shouldn't know? And then when they get in trouble, oh my mind. I have a colleague that he will do that. And I told him one time, I said, then would you please do your job and try not to do the principal's job? He got mad at me. He got upset with me, but I don't care. Because, you see, that CP, you can only talk for like 5 minutes straight. I laughed about that because there are people who talk more than that. And I have a friend of mine, he's got a ham radio, or he had a ham radio. And he loved it. Go in about 5:30 every night, 6 o'clock at night. And I'm like, how in the world is he talking to a guy from Australia? And you could hear the guy talking. And he would be like talking to my friend's identifier, handle. And people all around the world, Germany, Great Britain, were reporting not only the time and the weather. That's all they did. That's all they did. And yet the one thing he needed to do, and he always was required to do, was to say, sign off. You and I have a sign-off time. You and I have a sign-off time. One of these days, the time will be no more for us. And we won't be able to stand ready. We won't be able to stand ready before the Lord. In Malawi, there is a congregation there. And my mentor, the one I was telling you about this morning, the late Arthur Hinton, he would go to Malawi from time to time. The old Rhodesia area along Zimbabwe. And he said, those people were wonderful. He said, if you preach an hour, that wasn't long enough for them. And they're just like the people in Canada. They want an hour and a half sermon. Kind of ironic, you know, it's illegal to talk about homosexuality, but they want an hour and a half sermon. And he said, those people just sit and just couldn't get enough. And he brought back a report. It's one of my just don't know it the way I told it. This illustrates Paul's point, by the way, in 1 Corinthians 14. Let me try to help you out a little bit. Savior, sweet and peace, help you some way tonight, let us know what we sin. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the glow that makes me white as snow. we continue thanks what's in the cup. Jesus said it's his blood shed for the forgiveness of our sins. Took that fruit of the vine. He said, take it in remembrance of me. In Jesus we pray. Amen. Let's sing the first and last stanza of 612.
Thank you.